Okay, on the now, still doing Egypt, and I have 2, 3, 6 more to do. Then once I've done the Egypt tours, then I'll start working on the pyramid ones. Pyramid mostly being all in the same places from here on up to the Great Pyramid. I'm really hoping that Odyssey has this DLC too. Or DLC like it, it's pretty interesting. With it, you can just run around in the game if you want to. There's no combat, but you can learn a lot and see a lot. Maybe even inspire my research in Egypt and all the interesting things that is involved in it. Maybe even see the kingdoms in a different way and in history in a different way. The thing also to remember is that this is still a simulation within a simulation, if that makes sense. Because what you're playing is this character right here in an animus, which is a machine inside the game itself. So the entire game is a simulation that you're playing as a player. You're playing a person who is playing a simulation. And assimilation is an interpretation, which is why some things are a little bit different and can be a little bit different historically. Not just for storytelling purposes, but also because what you're seeing here is generated by the animus. So you're looking at an interpretation by a machine in a game. It takes a little while to get used to. As you see, you don't have to worry about anyone attacking you, and you can walk around with these magnificent creatures. Granted, in the regular game, and normally they are very, and can be very dangerous. But there's no fear for them there. And most of the time, not even in the game, you can just avoid them very easily.
Welcome to the city of Memphis. Throughout all ancient Egyptian periods, cities had one thing in common. They were situated along the Nile's shores. Cities were often designated for government or for worship. Major cities had several temples dedicated to numerous gods and goddesses. Egyptians referred to the organization of their cities as a sepat, or later on by the Persian term nome. There were 20 sepat in Lower Egypt and 22 in Upper Egypt. The capital city of ancient Egypt changed many times over the periods. One of the largest was Memphis, located in Lower Egypt. It was a key center for religious temples, including their most important deity, Ptah, god of creation. Thebes, located in Upper Egypt, competed with Memphis and featured as both a political and a religious center. Two important temples, Luxor and Karnak, were built there. A minor capital of the Saeide dynasty was the city of Sais. This was the last native Egyptian capital of Egypt. During the Third Dynasty, under Pharaoh Djoser, Memphis became the first religious and administrative capital of Egypt. Even when the political capital of Egypt decentralized itself, pharaohs were crowned in this sacred city in order to legitimize their ascension to the throne, up to and including Alexander the Great. Though little remains today save ruins south of Cairo, we can guess at the structure of the city, which stretched up to 5 kilometers in length and 2 kilometers in width.
It would have been pretty impressive to see it. Be interesting if we actually did have an animus where you could see some of these older places.
Memphis was also referred to as the city with 100 doors, or the white walls. These names were in reference to the wall which surrounded the city. Under the protection of Ptah, god of craftsmen, the city was a thriving religious and economic hub.
The Aeneid.
Welcome to Artisans of Ancient Egypt.
I think I've already done this one. It's just that last tour dropped you right in the middle of this one. I'm gonna go over to this one. This will also let me know if I can switch tours, which I didn't test earlier. Okay, it just dropped me. The crazy person running through the water with crocodiles.
Ah.
almost at the tour.
Welcome to the major regions of Egypt. Life in ancient Egypt was concentrated along the shores of the Nile and divided into two regions. Lower Egypt was situated on the Nile Delta near the Mediterranean, and Upper Egypt was at the south, reaching into Africa. Due to its proximity to the Mediterranean, temperatures in Lower Egypt were less extreme than in Upper Egypt.
Most of the base game follows Upper Egypt, and you can see the volume on the map itself. That's the what looks like a leaf.
Until 3100 BCE and the unification of Egypt, each region had its own pharaoh and crown. Lower Egypt's crown was red and marked with symbols of papyrus and bees. Upper Egypt's crown was white with symbols of lotus and sedge grass.
That's probably what some people might not realize, that there were two Egypts. And Egypt wasn't unified during the entirety of its existence. Well, ancient Egypt, that is. It's broken up into three different periods, for the most part. The Old Kingdom, the Middle Kingdom, and the New Kingdom. With periods of chaos between the
both
two.
Regions had Three. Competing major cities, most notably Memphis in Lower Egypt and Thebes in Upper Egypt. There were different religious cults in both regions, each worshipping their own major gods.
Well, maybe I just mixed up the two, Upper and Lower, because the Nile goes from south to north. Yeah, I did mix them up.
Many of the temples were designed in such a way as to represent the two regions, and ceremonies often incorporated Upper and Lower Egypt in their rituals.
Deserts. Two in the Fayum, one in the Black Desert, and Haris Nome. There's the Haris Nome. There's the Black Desert right here. That'll be the last one for Egypt. Or maybe I should do this one last. That'll put me right in the good position for the pyramids. There's one way down here. Now one of these will be last. I'm gonna go over here. That way I'll do one of these to start here and then work my way up. It's always interesting seeing a mountain run. Oops. Thankfully you can't harm them. I guess that would be the most efficient way. This one will take me by the pyramids that I'll be exploring later.
Three things are necessary when exploring Egypt. Water, a good camera, and an omnipresent voice coming from nowhere.
It's good they have such humor. A narrator, that's what you need. Most importantly, you need water, but you also need a narrator. Sort of reminds me of the saying that, about only becoming really lonely when the voices in your head stop talking to you.
Welcome to Natron is a colorless salt that was used by ancient Egyptians for food preservation, cleansing products, and glassmaking. It was also used in the mummification process. During the ceremonial embalmment ritual, the priests packed the body in natron in order to remove all of the moisture. Once the body was thoroughly desiccated, they could begin the wrapping. Natron was mined in Wadi Natron. The main mining methods involved either cutting slices out of the lake bed when it was dry, or raking through mineral-saturated water to gather the mineral salts during the floods. Both techniques are still used today and inspired the team in their recreation of the mines located in the mountains northwest of Memphis.
There's a fairly important mission here during the course of the game. A bit on the tragic side. Now to the Black Desert, and after I do this, I might stop by this area right here before I continue on. Unfortunately, you cannot change your, mount in this game. Up and over then. Which is also not bad. You don't have to worry about injuring your character. If you look up now and then you see a bird, that's Sinew. So it's one of those interesting things where Sinew is always there, you just switch camera angles. She's not summoned when you call for her. Or rather summoned and then vanishes. You call and need her. It may not be a road that goes the entire way.
Whoa!
You often see pots, oil pots, floating in the water. And what I think that is from a person in a boat being spawned in. And then, crashing or sinking our boat for one reason or another. There's various rocks that are not as deep as you think they are. So sometimes I've noticed the NPCs will wreck their own boat, although not as often. So it might also be that every now and then a pot is actually spawned directly into the water. But then again, you don't see that many pots of oil, so it could be what I just said. At any rate, the pot on the boat, or the pot of oil on the boat, is, from the looks of it, considered a separate item from the boat itself. So when the boat crashes, the pot of oil falls into the water and doesn't break in that instance. Whereas you can actually shoot it with your bow. Otherwise. But anyway, that's why I think you see some of those pots of oil that are floating around. Great place for a fort.
You can use a mount to cover long distances quickly.
I think they're reminding me because I had set such a long path. But this is the fastest mount you can use in this one, and you can't change it, unfortunately. nice. That's a nice one right there. It's easy to forget how large the game is. And even so, it's not nearly as large as the actual place. Be interesting to see a system that would handle a one for one. Game, basically 1 mile. Well, the actual map being 1 mile inside the game itself. EY is just up ahead.
Welcome to Deserts of Egypt. Reaching out on either side of the lush Nile are the harsh, arid western desert and the mountainous eastern desert. They cover nearly 94% of Egypt. Each of these parent deserts have their own microclimate and contain several smaller deserts with a distinctive fauna and flora. Whale fossils were discovered within the depths of the Sahara. Known as the Valley of the Whales, this location is evidence of the seas which once covered the area.
Now that is interesting.
The White Desert in the northeast of the Sahara owes its name to its white limestone soil, contrasting with the yellow sand. The wind has eroded the rocks of the White Desert into stone mushrooms, the most famous of which is referred to as the Finger of God. The Great Sand Sea is a large unbroken desert that reaches out through western Egypt and eastern Libya. It is home to a unique geological formation known as Libyan silica glass. The pale yellowish-green material ranges from pebble-sized fragments to glass rocks the size of rough boulders.
A little bit too steep for him.
Whoa! Yeah!
You almost feel like you're running around on another planet. Almost there. It's one of the it's fairly a fairly important site that I'm heading towards. How you would traditionally see a desert. Flowing sounds. The puzzle here is pretty interesting. If you've already played a game, you know about it. If you haven't, it's when you, well, you'll want to do it anyway. Yeah, I believe you end up having to come here for, say there's a mission involved here too. Anyway, it's pretty interesting. No damage. You mostly run along the upper side of it. Seems a few people have taken pictures here too. It looks like someone just finally cut a lot of the areas. It looks like some of the items are still in the game. You just can't pick them up. But here it is. Okay, on to the next one. I'll be right here, and then I'll go to Crocodilopolis, the last one. Up and over is probably going to be the fastest way. Place where you end up fighting two elephants at the same time. See the arena when you face them. so easy to get distracted by the things that are around you, the environment, especially in a game like this. Assassin's Creed keeps getting better and better at it. In crafting worlds, that is. Even the limited Assassin's Creed 1 is fairly nice. Last one for Egypt is the Fayum. Fairly important area.